The slicer, a mythical piece of software that decides the fate of your every 3D print. To tame it, you must first learn its language and appease the demons that live within. At least so it seems. Today we're going to go over the common settings you might want to adjust to get better prints out of your filament printers. We don't have a brand sponsoring today's video, but you know who is just as important in keeping this channel going? Well, all of you who are directly supporting me on Patreon, YouTube memberships, or otherwise. Seriously, thank you. Without you, this entire thing wouldn't be possible. If you want to find out how to directly support the channel as well, check the info in the description below. And yeah, let's get back to the video. Right, so for this video, I'm going to be using Prusa Slicer. Even though the name doesn't suggest it, it actually works for any filament printer that accepts standard G-code, which means basically every relevant machine. Some of the settings might have slightly different names in Cura or Idea Maker, but the ones we're going to look at today all work in the same way between different tools. But before we move over into the settings, let's start here on the plethora tab. This is the view that you'll be using the most for actually printing stuff. So obviously, after you've pulled in your model, you've got the basic tools of moving, scaling, and rotating parts, as well as automatically arranging models on your printer's workspace. You've also got the 3D preview of your parts right here, but there are two neat features in here that you might miss. First, you sometimes end up with parts that don't have their right side up. You usually want a large, flat surface to stick to the build plate. Now, you could use the rotate tool and shimmy it in place, and that's doable, but you've also got the lay flat tool that auto detects ways how the part could lay down and just lets you pick one of the options it's giving you. Really quick, really effective. The other one is the slice Z tool that if you have weird models that don't have a flat bottom, you can use that to slice off a bit of a part and get that nice clean bottom. You can also use it as a simple way to split parts in half that are maybe too tall to print in one go. All right, so over here you have the first few actual settings that you can tweak for a print. Of course, there are some presets up here which change everything, but those are something that not every printer has. I mean, typically on printers where I run my own profiles, I've got one, maybe two or three profiles that I can switch between, but really I'm mostly going to be using one compromise profile that works for everything. But if you do decide to tweak stuff, these are a great way to at least save a backup of your status quo and then later compare how the results of your new settings differ. The three config options you get right here are supports, the infill ratio, and brim. Let's start with the infill ratio. This determines how dense that supporting structure on the inside of your parts is going to be. Now, putting more filament into the infill isn't the best use of material if you want to increase the strength of your parts. Its job is actually more to support the top surface. Think of it as a roof of your print, so that that has something to rest on and doesn't cave in. And also to tie together the walls of your parts. But like I said, if you want a strong print, a thicker shell, which we're going to look at in a second, is much more efficient. So typically, you're going to be using anywhere from 10 to maybe 40% infill at most. Next, support material. If you've got parts that have geometry that's hard to print, support material can help, well, support it while it's being built up. The option support on build plate only isn't something I ever use because usually it doesn't generate support material in many spots where I'd actually want it. So for me, I either go everywhere or for support enforcers only, which is a really handy feature you have where you can overlay extra shapes on your model to tell the slicer where you want and don't want support material. Now, support isn't a perfect solution, which is why you generally want to use as little as possible. It uses extra material, makes prints slower, and usually leaves a surface finish behind that isn't particularly great. You'd be surprised how far filament printers can go without needing support material, and usually, parts designed for being 3D printable will already have taken the limitations of the process into account. Lastly, we've got brim, which creates an extra lip around your part that helps it stick down better. If you've got parts where the edges tend to lift up or where it just has a very small surface area for bed contact, brim is an easy solution and is fairly easy to peel off or slice off after a print. Okay, so that's the plethora. Let's head over into the settings tab. Right now we're in simple mode, which hides many of the settings for tweaking a printer's performance. Like I said in an earlier video, tuning or tweaking a profile is not trivial, so we'll be looking at the settings that you'd be changing to better suit a particular model independent of what printer you use. And the very first setting is one that I'd actually rarely change, and that's layer height. It should be fairly self-explanatory what it does, but since so many of the currently hidden advanced settings would get thrown off by changing the most fundamental setting, layer height, I usually leave that the same throughout. 0.15 millimeters is a fairly fine layer height already, but you might see anything between a quarter and three quarters of your printer's nozzle size, which usually is 0.4 millimeters. That means layer heights between 0.1 and 0.3 millimeters. And that scales up and down if you're using a different size nozzle. Printers that don't have auto bed leveling might have specific layer heights where they work best at. Next, everything related to the solid shell of your part. Now, the way that this is laid out is honestly kind of unintuitive. It has historically grown into what it is now. Every slicer does it like this, but really these settings could all be condensed down into a single setting, shell thickness. But as it is really granular, so let's go through it. Okay, first, the horizontal wall thickness within each layer is the vertical shell counted in perimeters. Basically, you're setting how many times your printer is going to go around the outside of each layer, laying down an extra filament line before it moves on to filling the inside with infill. The equivalent to that vertically would be the solid layers that cap off the top and bottom of your infill. If you want, for example, a fairly strong 1.5 millimeter shell all around your part, you're going to have to do some math with how things are currently laid out. So with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, which is actually set to lay down a line slightly wider than that, you need four perimeters, and with a 0.15 millimeter layer height, you need 10 solid layers top and bottom. For the solid layers, you could also set, you know, specifically in Prusa slicer, set one top and bottom layer and then use the minimum shell thickness to have the program itself figure out how many it actually needs. The lowest I'd go here would be a 1 millimeter shell. That's barely enough to give you usable walls around the sides and have a top shell that won't have the infill structure printing through. With bigger thickness for stronger prints, you might also want to start increasing the infill ratio at some point. Probably the most I'd do is like 5 millimeters for a shell and then about 40% infill. Anything that needs more than that should maybe be a part made from at least a stronger plastic or maybe even machined in metal. There's one more setting in here, spiral vase. If you want no infill and just a single continuous perimeter all the way around your part, you get a bottom, you get no top to print the vase. Next, infill. Really the only setting to adjust is the fill density. Less density gives you a coarser, less dense pattern. Now for fill patterns, there are a lot to choose from, and probably two thirds of those are kind of fringe applications or because it sounds cool patterns that have been carried over for years, but nobody should ever use them. The ones that I would say are worth using are triangles, cubic, and gyroid. They're all patterns that support your prints in all compression and shear directions, which should give you fairly consistent strength and stiffness in your prints. If you're being honest, triangle is probably the best one out of these, but cubic and gyroid are better on paper, but realistically, they just look cool. Gyro doesn't always print quite as fast as the others too. The top and bottom patterns decide how your parts get capped off at the top and bottom. Some patterns blend more nicely with specific prints, but for 99% of applications, rectilinear is fine. Next, skirt and brim. Skirt distance, you usually don't have to touch, and setting brim width to 5 millimeters here is exactly the same as checking brim over on the plethora tab. Maybe 10 millimeters is something you might need to use with some prints if you're using one of the warpier filaments. Then support material. And here I think the simple view mode is hiding a bit too much. So let's jump over into mode advanced. There are three settings in here that you should look at. First, generate support material. This one turns on or off supports entirely. Next, overhang threshold. This determines how aggressive the support generation is. An angle of 0 will only support the most critical bits of your model, and 90 degrees will try to support everything. Quite often, 30 degrees is enough to just help out prints that would otherwise show a bit of drooping or curling. Remember, every bit of support material you generate here is something you will need to peel off later. And when it comes to how easy it is to peel off, the contact Z distance is one setting that determines how big that gap between the support material and your actual part is going to be. Make it bigger and it peels more easily, but also leaves a more droopy surface. Make it smaller and it sticks better, but it's harder to remove and leaves more scars. Now, switching to advanced mode has actually opened up a whole bunch of other options just in the print settings tab. Now again, most of these you do not need to touch for every print. Also, it might be tempting to head over, for example, into the speed tab and try seeing how fast your printer can print stuff, but that will almost always be at the expense of reliability and quality. So in the case of the speed settings, instead of tuning up, I'd actually recommend tuning down first, because if you're simply printing at a constant, say 40 millimeters a second, there are now so many other things that can't cause issues anymore. Plus, the speed gain is not linear when you just allow faster max speeds for your printer. It still needs to slowly accelerate up to speed and then break back down. That's the sound that stepper motors make. But there are two settings that are only visible in advanced that are something that I use to easily get prints to stick. So first, you want your first layer height to be fairly large, maybe 0.25 or 0.3 millimeters. Well, that setting is actually always visible, but this will not just lift the nozzle higher for the first layer, but it will also pump out more material to make up for that extra distance. Combined with the other setting in advanced extrusion width first layer, which I usually have at a millimeter, you're increasing the width of that filament sausage being laid down as well. What that does is that now you don't just have a round filament sausage that's being dropped onto the bed, it's actually being smooshed down a lot. What I found is that, especially when you have a bed that isn't flat or level, or your nozzle distance isn't set right, this really helps your prints to stick down. But you might need to reduce the speed for your first layer if your extruder can't keep up. So over in the filament settings tab, there's nothing that you adjust for any particular print, but you'll find the basics for setting up a specific filament type. That's enough content for a video all by itself, so here's the quick version. First layer temperatures determine how well your parts stick down onto your bed. And it's usually a good idea to leave at least the bed temperature constant for the entire print, as some beds really like to bounce up and down as they heat and cool. Use the manufacturer's recommended temperatures for the filament, but it's actually not unusual if your specific printer reads its hotting temperatures 10 or 15 degrees too high or too low. So if your printer is split apart easily, increase temperature, and if you get melty curly issues, reduce temperature or turn on or increase the part cooling fan speed. The overrides page is, as the name implies, an override to one of the few tunable settings in the printer settings tab, and that's retraction. When you get wisps or strings on your parts where the hotend was moving from one spot to the next, you'll generally need to increase the retraction length. The other feature in here is Z-hop, which lifts the nozzle up by a slight bit in addition to retracting and sucking the filament back up. That's really useful to reduce stringing and reduce the risk of knocking over a tall print with the nozzle. So obviously we could go through every single setting, but we're already starting to blur the lines between what is something you can adjust for a specific print and what is printer tuning. In either case, the last thing you'll want to do is to hit export G-code and then feed the G-code to your printer on an SD card or USB drive. Let's recap. On the plethora tab, you get your basic move, scale, rotate, and the super useful lay flat tool. If you think your print needs to be stronger or more rigid than normal, increase the shell thickness first before you start using material for the infill. There are reasonable limits for all these settings. Resist the urge to start tweaking everything, but if you do, make sure you create a backup profile and compare the before and after. A good start to tuning things would actually be to detune and, for example, set your print speed to a chill, constant 40 millimeters a second. You don't gain much by having prints come out unusable or by failing outright. Slow and steady wins the race. But then again, every printer is different and what works for one doesn't necessarily need to work for another. So, that's it for this one. In the next video, we'll look at what the entire process of going from an idea to a part looks like. Until then, thank you for watching. Make sure to get subscribed, keep on making, and I will see you later.